of talk about the process, how this all came to be when you went before the JNC? Can you tell me how many members were there?
This process, interestingly enough, my application was January 27th, 1 year ago.
That's interesting.
When I went to my interview, it was in a large conference room, so there were a lot of people there. I'm going to guess there were about a dozen, I don't know exactly, but there were a fair amount of people there. And most of them asked me questions. Probably about 40, 45 minutes before then.
That's the longest I've heard.
Yeah, I probably talked too much about that. It was, there were a considerable amount of people. They were doing a number of interviews, I think.
Was there a speakerphone?
You know, they may have been, but there was no one in the meeting on the speakerphone.
So it's probably about 12 of the 21 members that were present.
It was, yeah, it would have been 11, but I think it was supposed to, it was around 10.
Councilor Dunville has said, I'm very impressed, you've done just about everything. And I really like to see someone your age with your life experience, because we're not getting them. And I think there's a little age discrimination somewhere along the line. Because I think someone who has not got life experience besides, you know, having 36 years, is it?
36, yeah.
That's what I look for as far as private practice. That's what I look for. And I know my colleagues agree with me that, you know, I don't know all of them, but private practice to me, and I'm a lawyer, is most important, because you have an understanding of that lawyer coming in with a client, and that client's paying for the service, and you have to shovel your walk and pay for the, you know, for the copy machine that breaks, all of that. So you're coming in with a different perspective. And the other part of it is that if you work in a district attorney's office all your career, or attorney general, be given the cases. You chose who you were going to represent. And when you're in one of those public offices, you're halfway there. Please give you their report. So you have to start from, you know, block one. So, you know, I think that's very important you're bringing to the bench. Looking at your cases, Kevin Kelly, I went to that funeral. That was tragic. The brakes went on the engine. My late husband was a firefighter, but he was 2 years. And the letter from Eddie Kelly was very, very nice. And he's got a big job now, right? Yeah, he deserved it.
He's going to be the boss of it.
Yeah. You know, it just seems like, you know, people can have on paper all the qualifications, but what I've heard from everybody, Martin Phineas called me, who's a dear friend, and all the things I'm hearing about you, you have the demeanor and the temperament that I look for. We've had some people come through here, and I get calls, I get complaints, and lower the bow with some of them that come through. We had someone that went to the Superior Court 10 times. 10 times she applied. 4 JNCs, different JNCs rejected her. 4 different governors, this governor too. And she just won the role. She BMC right up every court she applied to. And so the last year she applied to the appeals and she was rejected. And she went for the 5th time, I think for the 5th time, for the Superior Court, and she got it. And I got calls a month later about. And it's not fair that people come into the court, and it's not fair that the judges who work with her. And so you don't know how pleased I was to see your resume and to see your experience. It's amazing. What is your most serious case that you've had as far as, I know you had a lot of civil, as far as a criminal case, what is the most?
Well, my criminal experience has been in the district. But I did probably lost the items on the brakes on robberies. They were serious cases.
You had brakes?
Bring up the trial.
Have you had brake cases?
Yeah, problem.
Tell In your opinion, do you think a sexual offender can be rehabilitated?
I'm not an expert in the field.
I'm not either, but I say no.
That's a very difficult question. The evidence seems to say that that's a difficult thing to do. I guess there are people out there who can't.
I've never seen one, have you?
Well, I think on balance, you probably need something to ask.
Well, you just let someone out after 22 years of prison or something, you was fighting something, living with his mother, and you raped a girl, and the neighborhood were very upset because they didn't know that he was living in the neighborhood. So, I don't know.
Yeah, it's very difficult.
Yeah. How do you feel about lobby conferences?
I've spent a lot of years with lobby conferences, so I think they play a useful role in what Ron Kwan now, for issues of transparency, but I think in trying to manage the case law, trying to get parties to see if something can be done, start resolving the case, a plea or some case, I think there is some work for that. If parties are pushing for it, I've tried to
How do you proceed with them? How do you proceed with the lobby?
Sometimes judges will take through the lobby, sometimes.
Is it recorded? I mean, is it recorded?
In my experience in the lobby, it might have
Do you think it should be recorded?
I don't know if part of it should be. It must put people away with the power. Work around, but again, the issue of transparency being important, probably paramount, is something we probably try to do. I would probably be doing more sidebar.
What about time standards?
There, I think they're a good idea in this report. Like every other right here, you don't always have it exactly as they laid out. I think you have to use common sense and try to be practical. You're dealing with attorneys with a very busy schedule, a lot of cases going on. So I think you try to take those into consideration. Big guidelines, don't know. You try to accomplish moving your case in that period. Sometimes.
Has there been a change on sealed records? I thought there was, but I'm not up on it. I don't know. When someone has a sealed record, it seems to me that it almost works in opposition to the person. It might be some little misdemeanor, and yet when that person's going for a job, they don't know whether he, was a sexual molester or he robbed a bank or whatever. And so is there any way that someone can, they can unseal? Is it always sealed?
I think most of the people will lose the fact in a situation.
I thought you said that they could see the record. I didn't hear sealed, and that's what I'm asking.
I think that's the last.
Do they see it? Yeah. Well, I'm talking about when someone goes for a job, not before a judge, goes for a job, and they see that he's had, has had some criminal, whether it's criminal, bull gasket, I suppose, activity, and they have a sealed record, so they don't hire them. Is there any way that that employer can see what the offense was? It just seems like talking about, like you've been involved with a lot of people obviously going to prison. I've heard a lot of things. We had, I always thought when a law was passed, and the governor, you know, and passed that law and acted, that it's a given. And I just read in the Globe a few weeks ago that there are severely affected mental patients that are in in soul confinement, and they're not. So yeah, and I'm just thinking, how does that happen when we have a law that was passed that would not allow that, and yet I don't know how this has been going on, because that was in Governor Patrick's administration. I mean, that to me, I don't even know how anyone is so inhumane how that happened. You know what I'm talking about? They're in solitary confinement.
Yeah, I know it's more of a constant kind of telling what the management programs are.
There must be some place they could put them, you know. I mean, it's just like
there.
You served on the Boston City Council for 5 terms. How do you think, how does that make you a better judge, or have you learned anything from that that you will take? I served 28 years on the council, I know.
Well,
not easy.
I think it's, you know, it's the interaction with people. If you represent the last constituency, there's a district city council, you deal with people's problems. For you with issues that obviously need a problem, but I think that experience helps me help me to understand these issues and deal with people better, that translates into being a better judge.
I mean, I feel that being with myself. I mean, you people call and when you're city councilor and get problems and you respond. You interact, and you know, like you said, the district court is the people's court, so you can understand some of the problems that are coming in. Well, you've covered it all in your legal experience, that's for sure. How much pro bono work have you done?
A lot. I mean,
yeah, I can imagine 36 years, yeah.
If it ended up doing work for people for nothing, it's
right.
An issue of pro bono. You know, they're a tough situation. Friends get help from people all the time. You know,
in 36 years, especially in the society, have you had a lot of cases that were drug related?
In the criminal practice, you know, I've certainly had drug cases. I really haven't had a private practice where I've represented people who maybe drug
abuse. One of your clients that, you know, is drug addicted.
Oh, sure.
The governor talked about opioids the other night, and I don't know if you know the recent figures that Massachusetts is sixth in opioid death in 2015 in the whole United States.
It's a horrible problem. More and more aware, because I don't think anyone escapes. Who you are, you know, a friend or a family member or somebody that has had somebody infected. Oftentimes, quite tragically, as a result of death, these things obviously ruins the individual's life. They love these people.
Well, it just seems to me that drugs have been in the Roxbury, Lawrence, those neighborhoods for years, and it never got attention until it got into the suburbs. Don't you think?
Yeah, that's probably true.
No, I think it affects everybody. I had two close friends who lost sons of heroin. Do you think we have enough treatment centers and beds for drug addicted people?
No. I mean, if you talk for patient people, that's the greatest problem. And the issue is, I think the mindset is to try to get treatment.
But they're not getting the money from the legislature, they can't do it. I know.
Well, the problem is pretty much.
I know you don't have any, any authority over it, but you have to have my first question. One of it would be, when you think about community courts, obviously, I think I know the answer because you want to go to the district court.
Well, obviously, it's not support of community courts.
But they're combining them and moving them. I mean, look at Cambridge going to Woburn. How does anyone get a bus to go to Woburn, you know?
I mean, that's the problem. Constituency of community of course, so people who may not have the means to move around to these people. So that's an issue. And it's important in these communities to have their court available that is involved in play for that court. The presence of the community, I think it's ill advised. I know everyone has budget constraints and these things can be difficult, but I have it.
There was, in reading all of your legal work, there was one case, and it was Judge Mills, and you started out as a law clerk with that, and it was someone who was innocent, Bobby.
Yeah, Bobby Jolie.
Yeah. Can you tell me about that?
Yes. And he did 16 years. For me, Bobby Joe, at least the most nice guy, but I was very happy to be in person. As a young law student and an attorney, the lesson there was watching Bobby's son Chris, as advocates for Bobby Joe. I think it was an important lesson. Really eye opening for me in the real world. And this was a case that they had a dotted determination of the justice to be done. Just when, Bobby Joe had some other attorneys, abuses got involved, ultimately his life changed. I was able to be involved, student writing, as were a number of people. But it's truly a lesson of what a difference it can make. I think it was a great right before my own eyes, real life experience. I'm glad it happened so early in my career to see how that situation.
Were the people that set him up on this?
No, there was an armed robbery at Rochester. Bobby Joe had been picked up later and stuff that really not. Trial, jury, drop the case,
And I do want to mention that we did get the letter from Kelly, beautiful letter from the International Association of Firefighters, and Captain Rose, the president of the BCPA, and also Eddie Kelly. And, a letter from Chad Hughes, which is very nice. And they also spoke to Social Fire Bill and and Maureen, and it was very heartfelt, and they said about you. And I won't read all the letter from, you know, from the judge, but, you know, he's known you since law school.
I was commenting.
Yeah, a lot of experience. Yeah.
High school.
And I recommend him for his first law position after his graduation from Suffolk University. He's so he really knows the person, rather, you know, besides being an attorney. And I've been friends since 1970. And
the Hughes family is very good to me. They gave me opportunities to law school and the opportunity to be involved in practice.
That's great that you kept that relationship. He talks about your integrity, compassion, and intelligence, and your temperament, and empathy, and skill, and knowledge of the law. And those are all things that, you know, Maureen told me too. So, you know, I could ask you a lot more questions, but you really answered all of them, and we met for so long. And I can't tell you, and like my colleague, I don't usually tell either, but I was so impressed, and I said, why aren't we getting people with this experience? You know, I mean, we had someone who only just court 21 years, she's been a lawyer, she hasn't been in court for 14 years. At her hearing, she couldn't answer how many cases she had, she didn't know how many trials she had, and it was awful. It was terrible, and counsel Drew and I, you know, oppose that. And you know, I don't find joy in that, I don't know, but we know that there's people out there in the immediate district that are getting rejected. And someone comes through like that, and it reflects on us, and the lowering of that. So I commend the governor for approving you. And thank God you got through the JNC, because I don't know. But thank you so much. And I want to extend my condolences about your mom. My mom had Alzheimer's, and it takes all their dignity away, and it's just so sad.
Thank you very much. Next, we'll hear from Councilor Kennedy.
When did you want this paper?
February 7th.
I'm going to move to the birthday. We obviously sat down and spoke a couple of times.
We did.
So I don't have any questions. Councilor Jubal and I don't always agree, but I think he hit the nail on the head when we talked about the breadth of experience, life experience, legal experience. And nobody's touched on. We talked about the vast number of actual trials that people sit here. The only comment I'd make is to your family is that not everybody who sits in that chair has such an easy time. And that's a reflection of you, not us.
I appreciate the courtesy.
You do have the experience. You've worked very hard for a very long time to reach this point. And unlike my colleagues, I will tell you a vote.
Thank you very much, Councilor Kennedy. I don't have any questions. I've known Jim Byrne for a number of years. As Councilor Hennigan said, he served in the Boston City Council with my father. My father had such a great deal of respect for Jim. He was always calm, he was nice and even. Councilor Jubal always asked the questions, surprised he didn't ask it today, to the office manager. Did you ever see him lose his cap? I can tell you, I usually visit my father a lot. He was one city council, and there were a number of councils that would lose their time, but not Jim Byrne. He's a real superstar. I was impressed with the folks you had here today. Coming into work today, I talk to my sister every morning. She's in whatever. And she goes, what are you doing today? Jim, he appeared before me at the Alcohol Beverage Control Commission. Just all what a class act. Great candidate. I'd be more than happy to put your name before the council next week. thank everyone